Morning, family. Please keep your Bibles open to our scripture reading. We are in the series in our book of Luke, which is only done every first Sunday of the month. As you know, every communion, we treat it as so special, we will interrupt any series that we have. You know, going to the book of Joshua, so that we can focus on a passage that makes us look at Jesus Christ and all he's done for us. That's why we're going to the book of Luke. And this part of Luke, we said, talks about us to love as Jesus did. We must love as Jesus did, part one. Part two is next month. And this part of the book of Luke, Elder Dean and I were just talking at the back a while ago. We're saying, this is not really hard to understand. To be honest, when you were reading it, I'm sure you already got the gist of it, what it's really saying. You know, the problem here, it's really hard to apply. We need the grace of God to apply this. And I was reminded of a pastor who was concluding his sermon in the exact same passage we're looking at. So he's concluding. He wanted to end well like any good preacher. And so he was saying, in conclusion, I remind you all, forgive your enemies. And then like any good pastor, he wanted to end with a rhetorical question. He said, is there anyone here who has no enemies? Of course not. You know what? Suddenly, in the midst of the congregation, an old man raised his hand. He said, pastor said, why are you raising your hand? The old man said, pastor, I have no enemies. And the pastor said, that's impossible. All of us have enemies. And the old man said, well, pastor, I'm 94 years old. All my enemies have died. So, if you're 93 and below, please listen. This message is for you. If you're 94 and above, you can go home. But very briefly, I want to mention the context of Luke 6, 27 to 30. It's just a few verses down. It's in your outline also. Jesus said, in Luke 6, 22. This is Jesus speaking here. This is part of his beatitudes. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and revile you and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. What is he talking about? He's talking about people who are suffering for righteousness, suffering because they're Christ's followers, suffering because they refuse to give up Christian principles or a Christian way of life. He's saying this will cost you. It has already cost some of them, and it will cost us today. And he's saying, if this is what's happening in your life, this is now the lesson he's giving us. And why does this matter? Remember who we are supposed to be? Salt and light. What is salt for? Gives flavor. We give beauty and meaning to the rest of the world just by our very presence. We're meant to be blessings. What else? What does salt do? It preserves. So by the grace of God, as Christians live out their values that God has put in them through the Holy Spirit, we bless society at large, your family and your community. We preserve it. But salt is also, as you know, antiseptic, right? In fact, that's part of its preserving function. It's antiseptic. And sometimes in our antiseptic function, some get offended. The reason that you are like this, our family could be richer, but you, sir, dad, you want to be so honest. That's why the competitors have overtaken us. You're just too honest, dad. Persecution. Or business partner, you know, we could be number one in the industry. In this line of products but it's you. There's a problem with you. You keep sticking to your biblical principles and so on. Or your parents tell you, this is the person we want you to marry. Mom, dad, he doesn't even believe in Christ. I'm sorry. No, this is the person we want you to marry. I could go on, but you get the point. Sometimes following Christ could be very expensive. Salt. It's antiseptic and some don't like it. Light is good, but there are some who do not like light to expose what they're doing. And sometimes you will suffer for it. So I'm making a distinction, friends, that this is not about suffering for doing foolishness. Are we clear? This is not suffering for doing foolishness we're talking about this morning. It's suffering for righteousness. If I'm suffering because I'm doing foolishness, this is not the passage for it. There's another way of handling it. It's called repentance, and if necessary, restoration. You repent and then do what you can to repair the damage. You humble yourself before God and men and repair the damage. But today we're talking about suffering for righteousness. Let's ask God to help us understand His word today and prepare our hearts for the communion. Heavenly Father, we thank You even for the songs we sang together. They prepared our hearts, Lord, now to look into Your word. And now, Lord, as we look into Your word, may it prepare our hearts to worship our Savior and our Lord who died on the cross at the Lord's table. Enable us, Father, to see that our Savior preached this, but then He practiced it. And most of all, Lord, He demonstrated it when He loved His enemies to the point of dying for them on the cross. Because we know that God showed His love toward us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Help us love as Jesus did. Father, we confess this is impossible without You. But thank You that You enable us to do what You require. And You require this from us because You know this is best for us and best for the people we love and best for the people we serve. Thank You, Lord, for Your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, the question is, how can we love like Jesus? Well, let me say it from the start. How can we love like Jesus? Respond to enemies with forgiveness. And then treat everyone with God's goodness. Let me say that again. How can we love like Jesus? Respond to enemies with forgiveness. And then treat everyone with God's goodness. Emphasis on the word God's goodness. Because we cannot do it in our own strength, with our own goodness. It has to come from the presence of Christ within us through His Holy Spirit. So, we will look at this now, starting from verse 27, and I want you now to look at your Bibles because I'll read the first verse again for you. Luke 6, 27. Jesus said, "But I say to you." Why did He say the word "but"? Because He's referring all the way back to verse 22. Remember what He said in verse 22? He's saying that there are people who are making life hard for you. You've not done anything wrong. That's what He's saying. You've not merited it. So blessed are you, in verse 22, because people hate you, exclude you, socially revile you, spurn you, even perhaps in social media, and call you all kinds of names. That's what it means to spurn your name as evil, simply because you're trying to do what's right. That's why He said, "But I say to you, you don't have to be like them. You don't have to return evil for evil. You don't have to hate those who hate you. You don't have to exclude them because they exclude you. You don't have to revile them and spurn them because that's what they do to you." So He said, "But I say to you," and then one more, "but I say to you who hear." What does it mean? It's not for everybody. It's not for everybody. Again, because there are certain people who actually say, "I don't have to be a Christian. I don't have to go to church. I will just read the Sermon on the Mount, whether it's the Matthew 5-7 version or the Luke 6 version. I'll just read it, and I'll treat people the way Jesus wanted, and I'll do a good job, better than you church-going people." You know what the problem with that is? It's impossible. It's impossible. In fact, if people who say that, "I'll just follow the Sermon on the Mount, and I'll be better than all the Christians," they're actually going to be very, very frustrated if they sincerely read it through and through, and they'll say, "My goodness, I cannot do this," and they're right. So who can do this? That's what Jesus said. To you who hear. It's not the world in general. It's to those who have one point in their life, confess their sinfulness before God. "Lord, I am a sinner." They have put their faith in Christ on the cross, dying for them. "Jesus, I believe with all my heart. You are my substitute on that cross, taking the wrath of God on you as my substitute. And I call upon you." Some of you use the term receive, accept. I prefer the word call. They mean the same thing. They all are faith because it reminds me always of the thief on the cross. Remember, that's all he did. He just called on Christ. "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." That's calling. So friends, if you've done that, then this message is for you. "But I say to you who hear." So let's look at four commands about loving others, which I will tell you are impossible humanly. These are impossible to do humanly. I like a phrase somebody coined. We don't know who it is. It's anonymous. He said, it's impossible, but it is Him, H-I-M, possible. Through Christ, we can do this. Through Christ enabling, through His Spirit, we can look at these commands and not get discouraged or demoralized, because it's impossible humanly, but in Christ, through Christ, for Christ, it is Him possible. Four commands about loving others. The first one, found in verse 27, is love your enemies. That's the summary command. I call it summary because the ones that follow are actually related to it. What does it mean? Well, it means two things. It means forgiveness. You forgive those who have broken your heart simply because you're following Christ. You're living a life of righteousness. Now they mock you. They revile you. They call you all kinds of things. They say you're the hindrance of our clan becoming number one in this area. You're the hindrance why you're not getting promoted in the office because of your Bible beliefs and so on. You are to forgive them. And the other part of loving your enemies is goodness. It's simply treating them with God's goodness, whether they deserve it or not. I hope you understand that's what loving your enemies mean, but we'll spell it out in the commands that follow. What's the significance? I want to focus on this because it's self-explanatory to love your enemy. What is the significance? It's what I want you not to miss. This command separates Christianity from all other religions. I did a little research, as much as I could. I have some hard copies in my library, some soft copies in my laptop, and I also consulted Mr. Google. Now, did you know that there isn't a single religion in the world that contained the same command of Jesus here, whether it's the Matthew 5 to 7 version or the Luke 6 version? There is no religion with the exact same command as directly, love your enemies. Buddhism has an indirect reference to it. Confucianism has an indirect reference to it. Sikhism, even New Age, Islam, Judaism, they have indirect references to the same idea. The closest is Buddhism. Buddhism is saying something like, if you have enemies, you don't have to hate them. So it's indirect because it will rob you of inner peace. So it reminds you of Kung Fu movies, right? Where the guy will kill the one who killed his master, but he has inner peace. That's why this sets Christianity in the words of Christ apart from all other religions. Because this is the only one where it says directly, love your enemies. And this leaves the directness and the bluntness of Jesus leaves no room for ignorance. Yeah, you cannot tell somebody, you know, I cannot love you. Jesus is not clear about it. No, he's very clear. No room for ignorance, no room for misinterpretation the way he said it, making Christianity unique among all other religions in the world. And obeying the command to love others, as you know, is what the world looks for among us who claim to be Christians. That's John 13:35. I hope by now you memorize it. What does it say? Some of you are King James people like yours truly. John 13:35, by this all men shall know ye are my disciples if ye love one another. It did not say, by this all men shall know if you're my disciples, if you go to Green Hills Christian Fellowship. I wish. But no. By this all men will know you're my disciples because you come from Jesus. You must be sound in doctrine. So the world will know you're a Christian. No. You must know a lot of Bible because you're from GCF. No. Because of the way you treat each other inside the faith community. So the world will look at us. The world is listening for what's happening inside here. And they have one or two responses depending on who you are. Oh, I heard you're fighting among yourselves. You want me to come to your church? I'll also fight with you. So I won't come to your church. Oh, they'll hear. Oh, I heard some church leaders. You disciplined them. But I also heard you're pulling out all the stops to restore them to membership, to restore them even to ministry. Wow. I'd like to be in that kind of a church where when people fall flat on their face, they're not thrown by the wayside or thrown under the bus, but they come together to help them get back. The world outside is looking at us. The world outside is listening for what's happening here. If they find out that we're the kind of community that's pleasing to Christ because we love each other, we treat each other right, they'll say, one day I'm going to drop by that place where they help each other up. They don't tear each other down. Because I live in a broken world, I might find my refuge there, and you know that they will, through the Lord Jesus Christ. But Pastor, how do you love your enemies? I mean, it's so clear here, but how do you get that done? Well, that's the wisdom of Jesus Christ, the greatest teacher in the universe. The three commands that follow, I believe, are ways of making you and I realize love is more than a warm, mushy feeling, okay? You see, I cannot come to Harold, my dear friend here, and say, you know, Harold, I love you. But then when I see him in the hallway, I don't notice him. I don't greet him. I don't talk to him. I pretend he doesn't exist. So he can come to me and say, you're lying, Pastor. You said you love me. You don't even talk to me. You don't even give me any notice at all. He's right. How do you know that love is real? It's not just a warm, mushy feeling. It's how you treat people. It's how you treat people. So let's look at what Jesus said at how we treat people. It's the three commands that follow. First of all, he said, love your enemies, then do good to those who hate you. That's action. That's action. Do good to those who hate you. Friends, hate is dangerous. Hate is like acid. You know what acid does, right? If you put it in the wrong vessel, it will destroy the vessel. If you pour it on others, especially on living skin, it destroys living skin. That's acid, and hatred is like acid. It destroys you if you have it. It will destroy the people on whom you pour it out. Hate is like burning down your house because you want to get rid of a rat. You know, yeah. Oh, I killed the rat. He's now lechon. But now you're homeless. That's hatred. It will never, never leave you unaffected. If you want it to be in you, it will destroy you as much as the person you hate. I was reading about a church pastored by someone, and it's in a depressed portion of the city where there were a lot of gang wars. And one Sunday morning, this pastor was obviously sad about what was going on right outside his church. You know, sometimes people would die outside his church because of the gang wars, he said. Some people believe in an eye for an eye. But in our neighborhood, it's two eyes for an eye. You can never even the score. You can only raise the stakes. What is he talking about? For example, one gang would kill one member of the other gang, usually drug-related. This gang will now kill two members of the other gang. Oh, you killed two. We'll kill four. And so on. That was what he was referring to, and all the congregation were nodding their heads sadly at the reality of the escalating violence. And at the wisdom of his words, you can never even the score, you can only raise the stakes. But does this happen only in gangs? It happens in families. It happens in clans. It happens in neighborhoods. You know, I've heard horror stories about how village homeowners associations are even more politicized than our government, you know? And the horror stories I hear are amazing. It happens in offices, office politics. Sometimes the same escalating cycle of hate happens in churches. How do you stop the cycle of hate? Jesus said it. Respond to evil with good. Do good to those who hate you. The cycle of escalation is broken when a courageous, faith-filled Christian finally returns good for evil instead of evil for evil. Then it's broken. I want to drive a practical application of this without betraying confidence. When it runs in families, you can break the cycle. For example, someone will come for counseling. Pastor, I came from a very abusive father. He's never expressive of love, and the only thing I remember from him was the beatings I got. And I've hated him even when he is dead. When he was, until now, I still hate him. Help me, Pastor. Why? Why do you need help? Because I become like him. When I lose my temper, my son gets it bad from me. Help me, Pastor. And the first thing I say, forgive your father. You need to let him go. Because this is the weird thing about human nature. When you focus on someone you hate, guess what happens? You become like him. You become like her. Because you can't forgive. So you focus, you focus, you focus. Eventually it becomes part of your soul. All the negativity, it becomes you. And so you, who vowed, I will never become like you, you abusive dad, you find yourself abusing your own son. Number one, forgive your father. Number two, ask God for help. Number three, if you have to ask forgiveness from your son, do it. Another situation and where you can break the cycle is someone will witness a very dysfunctional marriage in their parents. For example, the wife domineers the husband. So this young man makes a vow. When I get married, no woman will treat me like the way I saw my mom treat my dad. He gets married. And the poor woman whose love he won is treated like a doormat. Domineered completely. And so you realize it. And you come for prayer and counseling. Pastor, help me. My wife wants to leave. She's finally had it, and I am at fault because I treated her out of fear of what my mother did to my dad. I treated her abusively, emotionally, not physically. Now she wants to leave. Pastor, help me. What should I do? Number one, forgive your mother. Forgive her what she's done to your dad. Even if they're already in the grave, forgive her. And I also say this, you might need to talk to your daughter. Why, Pastor? Because your daughter is probably observing how you treat your wife. And don't be surprised. She's making a vow in her heart. When I get married, I will never let my husband do to me what my dad has been doing to my mom, treating her like a daughter. I will dominate my husband. You might need to talk to your daughter. Why, Pastor? You can break the cycle. You can stop it. It starts with forgiveness. Even if the people are no longer here, at least in your heart, and looking at the damage you've done and hoping to repair it. I'm not giving away confidence. I'm not betraying anyone's trust here. I just hope you get what I'm saying. If this happened in your family, the cycle of hate escalating, you can break it. It begins with forgiveness. And if needed, restoration. Do good to those who hate you. Break any cycle of hate escalating by doing good and returning good for evil. Number two, the second way we show love for our enemies is bless those who curse you. The word blessed here is not the same as the word blessed in the Beatitudes. You see, the word blessed there is makarios. Makarios is a state of blessedness that comes from God's delight or pleasure in you. So blessed are the poor in spirit is God will give you a state of blessedness because he delights in you if you're poor in spirit. This is not the same. This is not makarios, it's eulogeo. Does it sound familiar? Eulogeo is eulogy. Have you ever stood at a funeral? Attended a funeral where somebody says, I want to speak about the one who passed away. Okay, you can speak. What will you think happen if the person who stands in front will say, you know that guy there who's dead? He's the worst guy I have ever met in my life. You know, he said, and this and that. And this. You know what? If he talks like that, he will have his own funeral soon, no? He'll be lynched by the relatives. Why? Because by definition, a eulogy is what? Saying good and hopefully true things about someone. That's the word that Jesus used. Eulogize, say good and true things about people who do the opposite to you, who curse you. So if they're slandering you before other people, they're not willing to face you and say things to your face, But they slander you in social media, they slander you in groups. Speak well about them before others. So when they try to research, they'll find out, what is she saying about me? What is he saying about me? Oh, he's saying everything good about you. Maybe they'll repent or stop. What else? If it's face-to-face, if they criticize you face-to-face, they insult you face-to-face, what do? Well, do it sincerely. Don't flatter them, but appreciate them face-to-face. That's the opposite of insult. That's the opposite of cursing. That's eulogio. And Jesus said, I know it's hard, but that's what you do. Bless those who curse you. That's how you show love for enemies. The third one, it might seem third, but it's not less important. It's probably even more important. Pray. Pray for those who mistreat you. There are two reasons you pray. One, you pray for yourself. Why? Because look at this. Can you really do good to those who hate you? Very hard. Could you really bless those who curse you? Very hard. So what do? Lord, ako muna. I'm praying for me. Because when I see the person, I want to smash his face in. God help me. Don't want to end up in jail. Please, Lord, work in my heart. Help me forgive. Remember three reasons we gave you to forgive? I'll review them with you. Quick review. One, forgive for God's sake. Why? He mandates it. Remember what he said after the Lord's Prayer? If you do not forgive others, neither will God forgive you. God considers unforgiveness a big sin. He'll not forgive your own sin. Number two, forgive for the other person's sake. Why are you here on earth? You're here to bless people. That's why you left on earth after salvation. So forgive so you can be a blessing to the unworthy and undeserving and unlovable and unforgivable. Just forgive them. But the third reason, I hope you can still accept, because all three are powerful. The third reason is forgive for your sake. For your sake. Forgive so that you don't have to keep increasing the dosage of your anti-hypertension medicines. Forgive so you don't have to keep asking the doctor, You come, Dr. Bebet, will you please increase my medicines for reflux? Kasi galit na galit ka, nanggagalaiti ka. So if you forgive, maybe you can lower your dose of anti-acid. Because you've learned to forgive. Three reasons. God's sake, the other person's sake, and your sake. And I hope you take this seriously, friend. Now, why do you need to pray for the one himself who mistreats you? If you've not done this before, I challenge you to try it. You can't keep hating someone for whom you keep praying. You can't keep hating someone for whom you keep praying. You try it out. I promise you it works. You can't keep hating someone for whom you keep praying. You know why? In the same way that if I keep hating someone, I end up like him. If you keep praying for someone with prayers of blessing, not imprecatory prayers, okay? May I be clear? Because some of you might be praying, oh, pastor gave me a reason. Lord, I pray for lightning on his house. That's not the prayer. Or Lord, maybe a milder version. I pray for one flat tire for him once each day. No, not that kind of prayer. Lord, my boss is like the boss from hell. I heard his marriage is in trouble. Will you please bless him? Will you please repair his marriage? Maybe if his wife and he will get along, maybe he'll finally see my contributions to the office and start criticizing me and looking at what I've not done and maybe even recognize my contributions. Lord, this relative of mine who keeps fighting with me about the inheritance, I know he has a son who's fighting cancer. Lord, bless his son to survive cancer. Maybe she will stop suing me in court for money that's not even hers. Maybe we can work out sharing the inheritance instead of getting it all for her son with cancer. You get what I'm saying? Pray for their blessing. Pray for their blessing. That's what Jesus is saying. Pastor, these three things, they almost sound irrational. Love our enemies. Do good to haters. Bless those who curse. Pray for abusers. Pastor, this is upside down. You know what? Jesus isn't upside down. We are. We are. All this is saying for us to do. This is what we were meant to be. We were meant before the fall to do good to all people, not just those we hate. Before the fall, we were meant, we were designed to bless other people with our words. Before the fall, God designed us to wish the best for other people, to want the best for them, to pray for them in that sense. But after sin entered the human race, it all turned upside down. Jesus is not upside down, we are. He's trying to make us right side up. So Christian, this is what God wants us to become. This is what He always wanted us originally to be. So, twisted by sin, born fallen and broken, our instinctive responses are always wrong. So when Jesus comes and turns us right side up, we discover that, turning the other cheek saved me from a brawl or maybe a lawsuit. Giving rather than receiving was actually a source of blessing and fulfillment for me. Dying to self, as Jesus said, is actually real life at its best. Friends, God's ways are not our ways, Isaiah 55:8. But they are the best ways for us. How can we love like Jesus, respond to enemies with forgiveness, and treat everyone with God's goodness? There are four examples here I want to run through very quickly because we want time for our communion. But these are only referring to personal retaliation, okay? Let's be clear. Not criminal offenses or military aggression. So I hope somebody doesn't come up to me after the service and say, Pastor, I know that you're very, very upset over the West Philippine Sea. I will always be upset over the West Philippine Sea. You should, Pastor, apply your sermon. Stop hating the Chinese. I don't hate them, okay? I just want what's right for us and fair to us to not be taken away from us. I mean, it's just nonsense for someone to claim territory you can see from Zambales, you know? You can see it. How can this be yours, China? So this does not refer to military aggression or military bullying or criminal offenses. Let's look at the four examples. One. The first one is when someone strikes you on the cheek, Jesus said, offer the other also. This is a reference, as if you recall, to persecution for righteousness that's emotional and social in nature. I opine that this is not necessarily physical, although it might become. But this is limited to those persecuted for righteousness. How do you interpret this, Pastor? You need to turn to Matthew 5:39. The parallel passage in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew, which I believe is the same message. Matthew 5:39, Jesus said, when someone strikes you on the right cheek. So what is that? It's called because most of us are right-handed, it's a backhand slap. In Jewish culture, if you were slapped with a backhand slap, which hits you in the right cheek, it's considered twice as insulting as the normal slap with the palm. You get this? That's so you understand what Jesus said. For example, if a rabbi was to tell the whole community that this man is going to be excluded not just from the synagogue, but the entire community, he'll bring the man before everybody and slap him with the back of his hand on the right side and tell the community he's no longer part of us. It was considered the ultimate insult. So if somebody did that to you unjustly, you could actually go to the Sanhedrin, for example, and say, this rabbi in this synagogue embarrassed me in public. Please, serve me justice, and you can. What Jesus is saying is, in that situation, even if you can take revenge, don't. And I want you to understand that turning the other cheek is more an illustration of a principle than a literal action. It's simply saying, don't let vengeance run your life. Don't be vindictive. Trust vengeance to God. Jesus demonstrated this friend during his trial before the high priest in John 18, 19 to 23. You can turn there, but I'll summarize it anyway. It says there when one of the officers struck him in John 18, 22. Why did the officer strike him? Because the high priest asked Jesus a question. He answered it correctly. But this officer who was with the high priest thought he was disrespecting the high priest. So he probably struck Jesus either with a backhand slap or maybe struck him with his fist. So what did Jesus say in John 18, 23? Did he say, I just preached that if you are struck on one side, you give the other. Okay, so here's my other side. That's not what he did. John 18, 23, Jesus actually pointed out the injustice. He said, if what I said is wrong, bear witness about the wrong. In other words, if what I said is wrong, prove it. But if what I said is right, why do you strike me? That, my friends, is a Lord Jesus who's not giving way to hatred or vengeance, but neither is he saying, you hit me here. Here's the other one. I hope you're getting this. This is figurative. It's not literal. It's an attitude of not being swallowed up by vengeance. And that's demonstrated by Jesus himself. Now, Pastor, is there an exception to turning the other cheek? Yes. When physical harm is the intent. You know, Jesus is talking here about persecution for righteousness socially, emotionally, and maybe even physically, but when physical harm is the intent, like, I want to kill you. Why? For no apparent reason. I just want to kill you. Now, you're not going to be a good steward of your body and say, you can kill me. Because it says in the Bible, turn the other cheek. You stab me on the right side, here's my left. That's not what it means, okay? Exception is when crime, especially physical harm, is the intent. Self-defense is reasonable if you're alone. If you have recourse to the law, turn to the police. That's why God instituted Romans 13, 1 to 7, government. That's his role. So friends, when crime or physical harm is the intent, self-defense or turning to the law is reasonable. Now, the last three I'll just summarize because of time. They all refer to material and financial persecution still connected with you being a Christ follower. So Jesus said, when someone takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic. What does that mean? In those days, if you're very poor, and most of Jews were poor, you had three articles of clothing from the outside to the inside. The cloak, you know what a cloak is, right? It's an outer garment that you cover your inner garment. Your inner garment, if you're very poor, was just a shirt that ran from your shoulders down to your knees. It's called the tunic in our passage. And then if you're a poor man, the third layer is your loincloth, your brief, no? Today. So you cannot take this literally, okay? Jesus is illustrating the principle that if someone asks your cloak, you're saying, you want my cloak? Okay, you can take my inner garment also. You'll be walking around in your briefs. Okay? Not to be taken literally. It's simply saying, it's connected with what follows. If someone has a legitimate need, and then they abuse you, instead of returning what is yours, you are not to give way to hatred. A pastor, if that's connected to give to everyone who begs from you, does it mean that I let everybody take what I own? For this, let me read what Dr. John MacArthur said in his commentary in the book of Luke. He said, and I quote, "Give to everyone who begs from you. This command takes place in the context of borrowing and lending." I think that's obvious. The assumption is that the person asking has a legitimate need, since Scripture condemns laziness. So if someone wants to borrow from you, especially from the community of faith, two criteria. It's a legitimate need, the person is not lazy, then you can lend. That's what he said. That's what MacArthur is saying, and I totally agree. If the person has a legitimate need, is not lazy, you might consider lending. Now, what are the exceptions? Well, if I give something to someone, and that's harmful, for example, a parent, your son or daughter might come to you after this who's in college and say, did you listen to Pastor Ma? Pa? Give to everyone who begs you, so I beg you double my allowance. It doesn't apply. Because you know, if you double your son's allowance in college, he'll be at Starbucks instead of at school. Or maybe playing video games at Robinson's Galleria instead of being in the university. Because if it's harmful, you do not give it. The other exception, of course, is when what was taken from you is not just yours alone. I think it was 2014 when we went through the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5-7. Again, without betraying confidence, a businessman approached me and pleaded for an urgent meeting right after the service. I noticed he was in distress. So I, you know, accommodated it. Okay, let's meet at my office. Oh, what is the problem, sir? He said, Pastor, you just preached that we are to give to everyone who asks from us. Yes, I did. But Pastor, somebody borrowed a lot of money from me. Even my son's tuition in the coming semester is dependent. That's our family's money. What am I to do, Pastor? I said, that money wasn't yours alone. You just told me. It belongs to you, your wife, your children. Go run after him. Is he from our church? No. Is he from the other churches around? No. He's not even a believer, Pastor. I said, you have the law. Get what belongs to you. You have no apologies to give. If it belongs to you, run after it. Because it's not just yours. I don't want to hear of your son not going to college. Your children not eating. It's yours. Run after it. That's why you have Romans 13:1-7. And I'm glad he got it, and I pray he got it. So when what was taken from you is not yours alone, then you have the right to say, I need to run after it. Or, I cannot give it because this is for my son's tuition, and so on. I hope you get that. So let me summarize now the four commands as Jesus did in verse 31. In verse 31, Jesus would now give the summary, which is called the golden rule. As you wish that others would do to you, do so to them. Now, the word golden rule, the phrase is not in the Bible, but it's a good description. The golden rule. And here, I want to talk about something first as a reality in society. Reciprocity. What is that? It's the societal norm. If you're nice to me, I'll be nice to you. If you're not nice to me, I'm not obligated to be nice to you. There's nothing wrong with that, okay? Can I be clear? It's not sinful. In fact, it's the bare bones minimum that holds society together. Don't you think so? Yes. If you're nice to me, why will I mistreat you? So it gives some order to society at the bare bones minimum level. But Jesus is saying, you're not going to be limited to that. You need the higher standard. What is that? Christ-like love. And that is defined for us, not just in the commands preceding, but in the summary called the golden rule. As you wish that others do to you, do so to them. Now, may I be clear on this? The negative form of the golden rule was found in other religions, even during that time. Again, if you'll do your research, Buddhism, Confucianism, Hinduism, Judaism, all other systems of religion, most of them have the same version in a negative statement. This is how their statements is worded in other religions. Do not do to others what you do not want them to do to you. But the positive way that Jesus said it is far superior. As you wish that others do to you, do to them. You see the difference? What's the difference? Well, the version of Jesus is far superior because the negative form is prohibitive. It simply tells you do not. The positive version of Jesus is proactive. It tells you do good. So one is do not. The other is do good. So it's like the difference between prohibitive. Do not break traffic laws. Do not cross the center line when there are two unbroken lines. Do not weave in and out. Do not break traffic laws. Prohibitive. Positive. I see an old lady trying to change her tire on the road. It's raining. She obviously doesn't have the strength to change her tires. So I'll go out in the rain, give her my umbrella, and change her tires for me. Proactive. You get the difference? Negative. Do not do to others what you do not want them to do. Proactive and positive. Do the good to others that you want them to do for you. Now, somebody will say, "Oh, Pastor, isn't that self-serving still? I will do good for others so that they will do me good." No. You must not take the golden rule out of its context. What's the context of the golden rule? Do good to those who hate you. If you will now interpret that together with the golden rule is actually saying, do good to others, whether they deserve it or not, whether they will return it to you or not, you just do good. Why? You're even meant to do good to those who hate you. How much more those who are not your enemies? How much more total strangers? So the golden rule really means whether they will return it or not, you do good. It's proactive, not prohibitive. It's positive, not negative. So that's the golden rule that summarizes everything Jesus said. Let's close with these thoughts, friends. I want to emphasize that these are not done naturally by our nature. It's impossible. They require God's enabling through His Spirit. So they serve as proof that you are a believer because Christ has saved you already. It is an inner disposition, not just a list of rules that you and I are to keep. In our daily bread, I read about a seminary graduate named Jack. So like any Bible school graduate, Jack wanted to be in the ministry. So he applied to several organizations, but there was no opening. Finally, because of financial reasons, he had to take any job. And the only job that Jack got was driving a bus in Chicago. So while I was driving that bus, one day a group of gang members entered the bus. And when they got off the bus, they refused to pay. So Jack's, the driver, said, "Hey, you need to pay." They threatened him. That went on for several days. There alight on the bus, a group of them go down without pay, and Jack would always say, because he'd be in trouble, "You need to pay." One time, maybe they got irked. They drag him off the bus, they put him in the street, and they beat him unconscious. When Jack woke up at the hospital, he was bitter towards God and towards these gang members. And he said, "Lord, I prayed for a ministry, and what you gave me was this lousy job and a beating." Well, it's good that the gang members were arrested and sentenced to jail. But during the trial, God began replacing Jack's bitterness. God started to work in his heart with love and forgiveness. When the judge finally pronounced a sentence against the gang members of jail time, Jack asked for permission to speak. And he told the judge, "Your Honor, may I serve their combined jail time?" But of course, the judge was shocked. You know, the judge replied, "There's been no precedent for this. I cannot allow this." And Jack said, "Your Honor, there has been a precedent for this." And he explained that Jesus died on the cross for his enemies. To make the story short, the judge still did not allow him to serve the combined jail sentences. But Jack began visiting the gang members in jail, and many came to the saving knowledge of Christ. Love won over crime, even over crime. Impossible in our strength. Possible through Christ. You can't do this on your own. This is impossible. Have you indeed come to that faith point in your life where you put your faith in Christ, receive Him as Savior and Lord? If you've done that, He'll put His Spirit inside you, and then you can, I can, we can obey this command. What if I fail, Pastor? Oh, I fail too. I do give way sometimes to hate and unforgiveness. Then you ask forgiveness from God. If need be, ask forgiveness from men. How will you know you're a Christian? The desire never leaves you. The desire to do right never leaves you. Oh, I failed. I lost my temper. I let out a bad word. I let out an angry word. Lord, I want to begin aright. Help me. That's a Christian. Not perfect. But the desire of the heart is to please God. That's a genuine Christian. When we decide to live a life of Christ-like love, We will live as Jesus commanded and as he lived. Most of all, we'll discover in a love like Christ what it means to have a truly abundant life. How can we love like Jesus? Respond to enemies with forgiveness and treat everyone with God's goodness. Let's pray. Father, we just sang together that you are the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. So there are people in our midst, Father, who need that healing because they've been traumatized, they've been broken, even perhaps by well-meaning people or not, and they need that healing, Father. Let those who need that healing find it, Lord, through forgiveness. And if they cannot get themselves to do that, Lord, by your grace, put it in their hearts, we pray, because your Spirit is already inside them. Supply them with what they need, Father, for them to heal. And there are those who need grace, Lord, grace so that they can move on in their lives, move forward from where they perhaps have fallen about loving others, about forgiving others. And they need your strength, Father, to move to the next level of their lives and not stay where they are right now. We pray then for that grace on them to do what is pleasing to you in their lives. And Father, again, we confess, as we look at what we just read a while ago and studied, we cannot do this, Lord, in our strength. Grant us, Father, the grace to do it. And we know that you will, because you are a good Father to your children. Bless your people who have come. Bless those who worship with us online, now and after this. We commend them to your grace, Lord, and we do this through Christ our Savior's name. Amen.